The Curious Republic of Gondour and Other Whimsical Sketches by Mark Twain. Section 4. About Smells, A Couple of Sad Experiences, and Dan Murphy. About Smells. In a recent issue of The Independent, the Reverend T. DeWitt Talmage, of Brooklyn, has the following utterance on the subject of smells.
I have a good Christian friend who, if he sat in the front pew in church and a working man should enter the door at the other end, would smell him instantly. My friend is not to blame for the sensitiveness of his nose any more than you would flog a pointer for being keener on the scent than a stupid watchdog. The fact is, if you had all the churches free, by reason of the mixing up of the common people with the uncommon, you would keep one half of Christendom sick at their stomach. If you are going to kill the church thus with bad smells, I will have nothing to do with this work of evangelization.
We have reason to believe that there will be laboring men in heaven, and also a number of Negroes, and Eskimo, and Terra del Fuegans, and Arabs, and a few Indians, and possibly even some Spaniards and Portuguese. All things are possible with God. We shall have all these sorts of people in heaven, but alas, in getting them we shall lose the society of Dr. Talmage, which is to say, we shall lose the company of one who could give more real tone to celestial society than any other contribution Brooklyn could furnish. And what would eternal happiness be without the doctor? Blissful, unquestionably. We know that well enough, but would it be distingué, would it be recherche without him? St. Matthew without stockings or sandals, St. Jerome bareheaded, and with a coarse brown blanket robe dragging the ground, St. Sebastian with scarcely any raiment at all, these we should see, and should enjoy seeing them. But would we not miss a spike-tailed coat and kids, and turn away regretfully and say to parties from the Orient, "These are well enough, but you ought to see Talmage of Brooklyn"? I fear me that in the better world we shall not even have Dr. Talmage's good Christian friend. For if we were sitting under the glory of the throne, and the keeper of the keys admitted a Benjamin Franklin or other laboring man, that friend, with his fine natural powers infinitely augmented by emancipation from hampering flesh, would detect him with a single sniff, and immediately take his hat and ask to be excused. To all outward seeming, the Reverend T. DeWitt Talmage is one of the same material as that used in the construction of his early predecessors in the ministry, and yet one feels that there must be a difference somewhere between him and the Savior's first disciples. It may be because here in the 19th century, Dr. T. has had advantages which Paul and Peter and the others could not and did not have. There was a lack of polish about them, and a looseness of etiquette, and a want of exclusiveness, which one cannot help noticing. They healed the very beggars, and held intercourse with people of a villainous odor every day. If the subject of these remarks had been chosen among the original 12 apostles, he would not have associated with the rest, because he could not have stood the fishy smell of some of his comrades who came from around the Sea of Galilee. He would have resigned his commission, with some such remark as he makes in the extract quoted above, "Master, if thou art going to kill the church thus with bad smells, I will have nothing to do with this work of evangelization." He is a disciple and makes that remark to the master. The only difference is that he makes it in the 19th instead of the 1st century. Is there a choir in Mr. T.'s church? And does it ever occur that they have no better manners than to sing that hymn which is so suggestive of laborers and mechanics? "Son of the carpenter, receive this humble work of mine." Now, can it be possible that in a handful of centuries the Christian character has fallen away from an imposing heroism that scorned even the stake, the cross, and the axe, to a poor little effeminacy that withers and wilts under an unsavory smell? We are not prepared to believe so, the Reverend Doctor and his friend to the contrary notwithstanding. A Couple of Sad Experiences. When I published a squib recently in which I said I was going to edit an agricultural department in this magazine, I certainly did not desire to deceive anybody. I had not the remotest desire to play upon anyone's confidence with a practical joke, for he is a pitiful creature indeed who will degrade the dignity of his humanity to the contriving of the witless inventions that go by that name. I purposely wrote the thing as absurdly and as extravagantly as it could be written, in order to be sure and not mislead hurried or heedless readers. For I spoke of launching a triumphal barge upon a desert, and planting a tree of prosperity in a mine, a tree whose fragrance should slake the thirst of the naked, and whose branches should spread abroad till they washed the chorea of, etc., etc. I thought that manifest lunacy like that would protect the reader. But to make assurance absolute, and show that I did not and could not seriously mean to attempt an agricultural department, I stated distinctly in my postscript that I did not know anything about agriculture. But alas, right there is where I made my worst mistake, for that remark seems to have recommended my proposed agriculture more than anything else. It lets a little light in on me, and I fancy I perceive that the farmers feel a little bored sometimes by the oracular profundity of agricultural editors who know it all. In fact, one of my correspondents suggests this, for that unhappy squib has deluged me with letters about potatoes and cabbages and hominy and vermicelli and macaroni and all the other fruits, cereals, and vegetables that ever grew on earth. And if I get done answering questions about the best way of raising these things before I go raving crazy, I shall be thankful, and shall never write obscurely for fun any more. Shall I tell the real reason why I have unintentionally succeeded in fooling so many people? It is because some of them only read a little of the squib I wrote, and jumped to the conclusion that it was serious, and the rest did not read it at all, but heard of my agricultural venture at second hand. Those cases I could not guard against, of course. To write a burlesque so wild that its pretended facts will not be accepted in perfect good faith by somebody is very nearly an impossible thing to do. It is because, in some instances, the reader is a person who never tries to deceive anybody himself, and therefore is not expecting anyone to wantonly practice a deception upon him. And in this case, the only person dishonored is the man who wrote the burlesque. In other instances, the nub, or moral of the burlesque, if its object be to enforce a truth, escapes notice in the superior glare of something in the body of the burlesque itself. And very often this moral is tagged on at the bottom, and the reader, not knowing that it is the key of the whole thing and the only important paragraph in the article, tranquilly turns up his nose at it and leaves it unread. One can deliver a satire with telling force through the insidious medium of a travesty, if he is careful not to overwhelm the satire with the extraneous interest of the travesty, and so bury it from the reader's sight and leave him a joked and defrauded victim, when the honest intent was to add to either his knowledge or his wisdom. I have had a deal of experience in burlesques, and their unfortunate aptness to deceive the public. And this is why I tried hard to make that agricultural one so broad and so perfectly palpable that even a one-eyed potato could see it. And yet, as I speak the solemn truth, it fooled one of the ablest agricultural editors in America. Dan Murphy. One of the saddest things that ever came under my notice, said the banker's clerk, was there in Corning during the war. Dan Murphy enlisted as a private and fought very bravely. The boys all liked him, and when a wound by and by weakened him down until carrying a musket was too heavy work for him, they clubbed together and fixed him up as a sutler. He made money then, and sent it always to his wife to bank for him. She was a washer and ironer, and knew enough by hard experience to keep money when she got it. She didn't waste a penny. On the contrary, she began to get miserly as her bank account grew. She grieved to part with a cent, poor creature, for twice in her hard-working life she had known what it was to be hungry, cold, friendless, sick, and without a dollar in the world, and she had a haunting dread of suffering so again. Well, at last Dan died, and the boys, in testimony of their esteem and respect for him, telegraphed to Mrs. Murphy to know if she would like to have him embalmed and sent home, when you know the usual custom was to dump a poor devil like him into a shallow hole, and then inform his friends what had become of him. Mrs. Murphy jumped to the conclusion that it would only cost $2 or $3 to embalm her dead husband, and so she telegraphed yes. It was at the wake that the bill for embalming arrived and was presented to the widow. She uttered a wild, sad wail that pierced every heart and said,
$75 for Stoof and Dan! Blister their souls! Did them divils suppose I was going to start a museum? That I'd be dying in such expensive curiosities?"
The banker's clerk said there was not a dry eye in the house. End of section 4.